Hello, my friends. Dr. Lee Ray here. We need to have a chat about the eco-critical lens. We can compare it with the other lenses, of course. So the Marxist critical lens, the post-colonial critical lens, and the feminist critical lens. Each of these aims to look at any human text and sort of interpret it from a new point of view. It leaves our default preconceptions about texts and ways of thinking behind and lets us see things from a new angle. Now, just like the feminist critical lens is based on feminism, the Marxist critical lens is based on Marxism, the post-colonial critical lens is based on what we understand now about the colonial period, the eco-critical critical lens is based on eco-criticism. So we need to understand some of the basic ideas of eco-criticism before we can apply the lens to the texts which we have. So I've had a think about it, and I think there's two key concepts which, if we understand these, we can start to pick apart texts and tackle the fun stuff. So these two concepts are pretty basic. The first one is the Anthropocene. This is an epoch of time. And it's the time in which humans began to make changes to Earth systems on a global level. So when we're talking about the Anthropocene, we're talking about all the terrible things which are happening right now, the environmental catastrophe which is going on. We're talking about global warming or climate change. We're also talking about the sixth great extinction event. You might know that at the moment the rate of extinction of species can only be compared really to the most extreme periods of extinction in the past, like for example when all of the dinosaurs went extinct in the fourth extinction event. Now the second key concept which I want to look at is human exceptionalism. And surprisingly, this is still a very common one. So this is the idea that humans are separate and are apart from all other species, from all of the rest of nature. It's the idea that the humans have the right to exploit the world. And it leads to anthropocentric ideas. That's ideas where humans are at the center of the universe. So for example, if you go for a walk in a town and you see a pigeon, you might call it the pest. That pigeon has no right to be in that town is a human space, for humans only. The pigeon has no right to be there. So how do we apply these ideas to the texts which we've got? Now I think one of the easiest ways to do it is just to think of it as a series of questions. So here's some key questions which I think are quite important for eco-criticism. The eco-critical lens is really interested in whether humans are in control of nature or whether they're part of nature. Are the humans in harmony with nature? So in the picture we've got here, it seems to show lots of women planting trees. This is actually a metaphorical text, but of course there's no reason to suggest that women did not plant trees. So here, humans are very much in control of nature. They are creating an environment, creating an orchard. Second question, what can we tell about society's relationship with nature based on this text? Well, based on this text, of course, we can tell that humans are in control of nature. Humans have no fear of nature. There's a very scientific methodology going on here. Humans know exactly what they're doing and how to exploit nature. And that's quite a common set of attitudes to see. Now, question three, how are creatures on the boundary between nature and human depicted? Now, if you're lucky enough to be doing literature, you'll have all sorts of examples of this from vampires who are human and yet at the same time superhuman. Perhaps even tree spirits, creatures which look like humans but are actually part of nature. If you're not lucky enough to have any of those particular monsters around, you'll have to settle for other creatures on the boundary. So if you see in this picture, above the ladies planting the trees, we've already got a couple of what we call commensal species settling in. That's species which live alongside humans. But you'll notice that none of the women care about these jays. So that seems to show quite a positive relationship between humans and animals which live on the edge of human society. So a text with a little bit of harmony to it. I'm quite excited about it. Now, the last question to ask is, what is the role of nature in this text? And that might seem like a broad question, but actually it's a really easy one. And the reason for that is that nature is almost always fits into one of a few stereotypical roles. So here are the ones that I can think of. Sometimes nature is terrifying, and this is especially in sea stories, right? You can't trust the sea. You can fear the sea, and you can live by the sea, but you can never trust it. Sometimes nature is cool, and we see this a lot in documentaries about nature. Now, don't be fooled. Those documentaries still have, they're still coming at it from a very human angle. They are only interested in nature when it's magnificent and beautiful and oh so cool. If we get weedy little bits of nature, nature which doesn't quite fit in, literal weeds growing up in the middle of cities, not interested. We're interested in the wide, beautiful nature scenes. Sometimes nature is a kindly mother, so we still have the idea of sort of nature as a mother goddess, don't we? Mother Nature, who will look after you. Just trust in Mother Nature. Sometimes, more often than not these days, nature is a resource. And this is an idea we've got from the Enlightenment period, where nature is literally just exists for humans to exploit it. So nature needs to be carefully managed, carefully exploited in order to maximise production. Nature is just an object. Now sometimes, especially in literature, nature is there only to illustrate the story of what's happening with the really important characters, the humans. So here is a picture of The Notebook. The two people are kissing in the rain. Why are they kissing in the rain? Is the rain an illustration of their emotional outpouring for each other? Or is the rain a sign that things are going to go wrong later on? Sometimes nature is a pest. Nature is an adversary for humans. So here's Alfred Hitchcock's The Birds. You can't trust the birds. And last of all, I don't think this is a modern idea, because we see it all the way through through the medieval period, through the early modern period. Nature is a hero. Now again, we have to be careful with this, because nature is never a hero for nature. There's no champions of nature which we celebrate. We celebrate nature as a hero when nature is looking after human concerns. So dogs and cats are given medals when they save humans from burning buildings. In the medieval period, earthquakes might suddenly start up just when a righteous king is about to be slaughtered. Nature has a moral compass and is looking after human society. That's a myth which we see and which sometimes has a role in our texts. So what texts do you look at? How is nature portrayed in those texts? Have a think about it and let me know, because I'd be really interested to find out and try and apply this eco-critical lens to your own work.